So here I am with Jason Jones, artist extraordinaire, if you will, from Northwest Arkansas. And just want to talk a little about, so at what age did you realize that you had either a desire or a knack to create things?
Well, I was little when I first started doing this. And it's really one of my first memories. I was sitting down and doing a drawing of my parents, and they were sitting on the couch watching TV. I sat down in front of them and started sketching them. I think they were paying much attention to me. You know, I was really paying attention to the details of it, you know, and I really captured some, you know, their essence. My dad was sitting there, his shirt was hiked up a little bit, you could see his belly button, you know, I drew all the details in with my mom's curly hair. Anyways, when I was done, I gave it to him, my mom just kind of lit up, so. She was just ecstatic, you know, and she's kept that drawing all these years, and they've just really encouraged me to keep doing it. I just love to do it. I've never stopped. I was probably 4 or 5.
Really? Wow. So 4 or 5, drew a portrait of your parents, gave to your mom. It just moved her, and that kind of moved you, I guess, to see that your drawing moved her. So what's the next 4 or 5 years of Jason Jones getting through middle school, junior high, high school? What does that look like?
A lot of it, I just like to draw. You know, I just sit down. I was really introverted as a kid.
Yeah.
So we lived out in the country. So the neighbor kids were like a mile down the road kind of thing. So I just kind of, you know, I had a few friends, but a lot of times I was just did my own little thing, in my own space. So I was just drawing all the time, picking up the practice. When I got older, I was 14, my mom put me in, there was a local lady in West Fork where I grew up, taught some painting classes, and my mom put me in there. So I did that for a couple of years. It was just oil painting. And I did that. After that, they ended up, I painted, I think, the mascot in my school gym, in the middle school, and the high school gym. And then a local video store asked me to paint a fence.
Right.
Like movie scenes on it. I didn't think I had my driver's license yet. You know, I rode my bike down
right.
the day. It just kind of snowballed into.
So you... So after high school, I mean, did you do any official training? Is it all self-taught? Tell me a little bit about that.
After high school, I ended up going to the U of A.
Yeah.
And I got a bachelor of fine arts degree.
Okay.
And I wanted to do sculpture. I did quite a bit of that. The sculpture department wasn't very strong there at the time.
Right.
So I ended up just kind of sticking with painting. Actually, when I first started out, I started to do graphic design because that's where the money is.
Right.
I learned pretty quickly. I mean, I did well at it. I had a knack for it, but I just didn't like sitting at a computer. I'm much more kind of hands-on. So it didn't take me long to just stick with painting and sculpture and some photography. And it's kind of all over.
So what type of sculpture, when you say sculpture, what type of sculpture did you do?
It's mostly like found object stuff.
You know,
I grew up, you know, south of Fayetteville, you know, in the hills.
Right.
And, you know, it's easy hiking through there. You find a chunk, rusted metal stuff.
Right.
I never really learned how to weld, so I ended up taking like an adult ed class, you know, and bought me a stick welder and then started tacking things together, making creatures and whatever, it's kind of, to me, it's all kind of connected, whether if it's sculpture, photography, painting. I mean, it's all kind of the basic elements you're dealing with, light,
sure,
and texture. So I kind of like jumping from one thing to the next.
Okay. So what type of photography do you do? I don't know if I've seen any photography, but
Oh, it's been years since
yeah.
I took photography, but yeah, I mean, I had, you know, I did black and white photography in college, and
okay.
you know, after that, I had set up a dark room in our house, and I would just, a lot of them are just from the hills I would hike, and you know, I find some interesting spaces
yeah.
in nature and junk piles
yeah.
I would start digging through and doing stuff with that.
Right. So, what was your first, I don't know, did they pay you to paint the mural on the fence? Was that a paid gig, or do you?
He actually, I ended up painting it twice.
Okay.
I'm going to say 14 or 15 the first time I painted it.
Right,
we just kind of traded, you know, it was like the old Nintendo games and,
yeah.
you know, he had rentals
yeah.
and VHS tapes, and then, it was a couple years later, I ended up repainting it again with different scenes.
Right.
I think he gave me a couple $100 at the
yeah.
time. He was ecstatic.
Yeah, right, sure.
But he had called the local news media and stuff.
That's cool.
Thing out of it.
So when did you realize that, hey, I could actually, you know, make a living of some sort, if you will, doing this? I mean, what led to that? What was there a certain project, or was there a group of them, or?
It's kind of just slowly built up.
Yeah.
I mean, of course, nothing happens just overnight.
Right.
You know, I mean, I've been doing this for a living now for almost 20 years. I know it seems different, you know, people that don't know me, that just seems like I popped up all of a sudden. They're like, oh, this guy's good. He came out of nowhere.
Right.
But it's something you build, kind of. Of course, there's been, you know, thousands of things that I've done that are terrible or mediocre, you know, to kind,
right.
of, kind of get to the point where I'm at. But yeah, it's a business, and it's kind of like you have to learn out, you know, really think outside of the box.
Yeah.
It's kind of business too. It's not like something you can go and study another business because it's so different from
right.
everything else.
Got to learn from private
yeah.
states, I would guess.
Yeah, I mean, as far as like graphic design or something,
yeah.
you know, like, you know, you can talk to another graphic designer and learn what they're charging and how their business works
right.
and things. But what I do, like, I don't know anyone else that's doing
right.
exactly the same thing. And the other people that are, you know, our work's so different, so
right.
it's hard to compare and do things, you know, like that. So it's,
yeah. So what do you do? So what do you, is there a space, a place you go in your mind when you're doing your artwork? What's it feel like? I saw when I walked up, you had headphones. Was that music or what do you, how?
I do a combination of
sure.
music and podcasts. I'm
okay.
always listening to podcasts. You just get tired of listening to the same thing
right.
you know, all the time. So I kind of switch it up. But yeah, I love science podcasts and anything that kind of tells a story.
Right.
Yeah, it just kind of keeps you interested in going.
Right.
Otherwise, I know sometimes painting a wall, it's like you're just standing in one spot staring at the same
doing the same motion over and over.
You know, hours on
right.
end. You know, it gets kind of like, you know, joggy after a while. So it's nice to have a story or something
yeah.
really.
So you said science podcast. So what's an example of a podcast you listen to a lot? Do you have
I like
any
the Radio
favorites?
Lab a lot.
Okay.
That's one of my favorites. Oh, I've really been into the one, the Supreme Court. What's that one called? I'm drawing a blank on the name of it. More Perfect. Is what
right.
it's called.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's just, I like the ones that you just, they end up talking about something that almost sounds boring and mundane, but then once they start getting into it, you're like, this is incredible, you know,
right.
it's amazing.
Right.
So.
That's cool. So one of the things I like that you do, I think is interesting, is you take these old paintings, you find flea markets, I don't know where you find them, and you draw something on it to kind of change the picture. Tell me a little bit about how that started, why you do that, or what that's all about.
Well, that whole thing started with, originally I was going to flea markets or like thrift stores
right.
and just picking them up for cheap frames.
Right.
Because, you know, it's expensive to frame your artwork.
Right.
So I would get them and then I'd take the print out or whatever was in there and then just cut a board or make a canvas to fit the frame. And one day I had one setting in my studio, and it was like a Western kind of scene. It had like a ghost town looking thing.
Right.
The print had a big kind of like a tear in it, or like the first layer of paper had been
right
off. It was like a lithograph or something. I just had the random idea that I'm just going to paint a robot over that tear. People really loved it. So I just kind of ran with it. After I've kind of learned, I've learned about Wayne White, and there's some other artists that do
right,
you know, similar stuff. But yeah, I was just fascinated with that. I love color. I just really get into it. I'll just sit there for hours just trying to match colors and get the textures and the shape
right
and everything the same, you know.
Right. What do you call that? You call it a name. You have a name for that art.
I call them altered thrift store.
Yeah.
But yeah, there. I mean, it's hard to come up with a name because they're also different. Cause,
right.
Some are on prints. There's different kinds of prints. I've done them on oil paintings, acrylics,
wow,
pastels, watercolors. So I just kind of think of a broad name that'll cover all that.
Right.
You know, I've done quite a few on photographs. You know.
Yeah. So basically, that started with you trying to source reasonable frames, and then one day you just happened to look at one of your frames, if you will, and you decided, I think I'll just paint over that tear.
Yeah.
And then there it went.
And it was great because it was just, you know, it just upcycled the artwork, which is kind of, you know, that's an important part, I think,
yeah,
of my work is just, you know, sustainability kind
sure
of thing and reusing. I've always done that with my sculpture, even my photography. I used to frame them and found objects
right
and things where I would take the photos.
Right.
So I've always had that kind of upcycle mentality.
Sure. So tell me about the robots. You seem to like robots. So tell me, where did that come from? Or,
you know, the robots mainly is just because they're the first things that sell. But now there's, I guess the root of them kind of started with when I was in college, I started doing paintings of childhood memories. You know, I was just stomping through the Ozark Hills,
right,
and through the creeks. And I had, as a child, I remember having like a Grover doll, you know,
yeah,
from Sesame Street.
Yeah.
He was
love Grover,
big,
yeah.
And then just as I aged, just one day I realized, you know, I wonder whatever happened to that thing. You know, I'm sure my mom just threw it out, you know, after
right
I got
right
older and didn't play with it. So I started making these stories of like, well, maybe he just left the house and went on to adventure. So I did paintings of this little blue man kind of going
right
off to all these different environments and doing these things. And that's kind of morphed. He's kind of morphed from that little blue man into robots and monsters.
Okay.
It's that same kind of character.
Yeah.
Just kind of built on it.
So he's just basically exploring wherever.
Yeah, and I just like it because it's kind of, it's just kind of this like lighthearted character.
Yeah.
It kind of has a whimsy to it.
Yeah.
I always like. And then another thing with the robots is, especially like with the altered thrift store art, it's easy like to make them fit any size.
Right.
Like, I can make them look gigantic.
Right.
Or a little bitty, or, you know, so it's always,
they're easily scalable, I guess.
Yeah,
yeah.
Nice to fit in about any space.
Yeah, that's a great point. So so tell me about a couple of your favorite pieces. Do you have any favorite pieces that you enjoy what you got to do, or you got a lot of people really seem to love it, or you just enjoy the process, or just, I'm just curious.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not one to like really get into one thing.
Right.
So I end up kind of having lots of
favorites, yeah,
I guess. I really enjoy just jumping kind of back and forth from things. Like, I know when I do the murals, they're always exciting and it's a lot of interaction,
right,
and, you know, with the community and, you know, the property owners and clients and making things work.
Right.
It's physical and a lot of work, and I really enjoy that, you know. But then also, I like to get a break from that and
right
go back to my own space and get on these little small pieces sometimes,
yeah,
you know. So I kind of jump around. But yeah, I don't know. I really, I mean, it's with my murals, I think one of my favorites was this last year. I did the Green Candy festival they had in Fayetteville. I was one of the selected local artists.
Right.
I really enjoyed that. Because, of course, you get more freedom, artistic freedom
sure.
to kind of do what you want with something like that.
Right.
Festival, and I'm working along next to these international artists, which is
right.
really exciting. You know, I've idolized a lot of those artists
yeah.
for years.
So what did you draw to Green Candy? Which piece
so
was that?
The theme of the festival was like sustainability and
yeah.
conservation. So I had submitted 5 different drawings. And the one they chose, it's like a big jackrabbit.
Okay.
And he's sitting next to this like big glass terrarium thing. It's like a big gas tank.
Yeah.
He's wearing a gas mask.
Yeah, I remember this. Yeah.
That.
Yeah.
And there's a little landscape inside the terrarium with a windmill and a deer and some birds. So it's like he's breathing fresh air.
Yeah, that's cool. So do you have a favorite large-scale mural that you've done that stands out in your mind? Or?
I like that one, the jackrabbit.
Yeah.
And I did the... Last year, I did the big blue octopus.
Yeah.
In Bentonville. That
yeah.
one was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It was a challenging wall because it's the texture goes split face block.
Right.
It was a tough surface to paint on, but I really enjoyed it. I mean, it was a challenge. And,
yeah. How long does it take you typically to do a mural of that size? Or like, I think of the swing down at Fayetteville, the girl in the tree.
Or
the tree.
Yeah,
the
girl and that
thing.
One, the enjoy local.
Yeah.
It was about a solid month.
Yeah.
It was about 4 weeks.
Yeah.
I ran into a lift for 4 weeks.
Sure.
To finish the thing.
That time frame.
Yeah, and there's, lots of variables on those because you're dealing with the weather. And
right,
the
of course, yeah.
So
yeah.
It's kind of, sometimes it gets broken up a little bit.
Yeah. So when it comes to the octopus, are all those pieces that are on that drawing? I know there's Sam's truck. I know there's a tree in front of the Crystal Bridges. I know the water tower. Did
mm-hmm.
you select those or did somebody ask you? Or
That whole process came about with, originally they contacted me about, they wanted a postcard mural.
Right.
Real traditional, which I wasn't as excited about. So they kind of fizzled for a little while and they were looking into different options.
Right.
They ended up hiring Casey Meyer.
Okay.
I mean, she's an amazing local
right.
photographer.
Right.
Very creative.
Right.
And I don't know if they were working with her maybe to do something that could be photographs and vinyl, something
right.
up there, but it's all textured, so
right.
there's not really anything that would work well.
Right.
Plus the vinyl.
Yeah.
In my opinion, it just doesn't last as long.
Plus it's south facing wall.
Yeah,
it sounds
just
killing.
Looking bad
yeah.
pretty quickly.
Yeah.
It doesn't age well. So anyways, they kept her on and they came back to me and they were like, let's do a mural. And they were like, we want to keep Casey on to help with the creative end. So we ended up meeting with her and we flipped through sketches. And of course I've done lots of crackings and things. She loves octopus.
Right.
We talked about it and we're like, let's do it, let's,
yeah.
She's like, I'm really going to try to sell them this, and I was like, let's try.
Yeah, why not?
Because part of it was when I talked with them, with the postcard mural, it's real traditional. Everyone's seen one.
Right.
But it's just not that memorable.
Right.
And they had this vision where they wanted it. They want to represent Bentonville, and they wanted to put the landmarks in there. And my sell to them was, well, let's make a landmark, because they were struggling with finding what landmarks.
Right.
And they were like, there's a water tower.
Right.
They didn't really want to put the Confederate statue.
Sure, sure.
They were like, we could put the 5 and 9, but it was limiting.
Right.
There's Crystal Bridges and all
right.
that. But anyways, my cell was like, let's just make a landmark. This will be something everyone will remember. They'll be like, oh, where the blue octopus
right.
is.
Right, right.
Kind of thing. So yeah, it kind of morphed in that. They wanted to keep the landmark, so they suggested some things to put in there, like Sam's truck and the tree from Crystal Bridges.
Right.
Yeah, and it all just kind of worked out, you know. Sam's truck, it's like, you know, kind of a parking lot, so it almost looks like
he's
picking up the truck, you know.
Yeah. I thought the end result was really clever, honestly. Because the octopus, obviously, is the first thing you notice. And then it depends how fast you're driving.
Yeah.
You know, the longer you look at it, you go, oh, and you start recognizing the pieces. And it all kind of makes sense of why it's there and what it's doing. So if that was a collaborative effort, good job, you and Casey.
Yeah.
Good job.
Came together.
Yeah.
I was super stoked. You know, they went with something creative.
Yeah. So. No, that was really good. It was really good. So, what's the future look like? Do you you got anything you haven't done yet you want to do? Do you travel? Do you do this other places?
I don't know. I'm starting to get to where I may travel. I've had some people contact me. There was a real estate group contacted me out of Dallas not that long ago about maybe possibly do something.
Right.
I used to before it was. My wife worked for the university and I had my son and I was, you know, I'd pick him up from school and this and that. He's getting older now. He's 10.
Right.
I usually didn't want to travel much because I had my family and all that. But now it's more, I think I'm more open to it and ready. You know, of course, there's all these street art and mural festivals happening all around the world. So,
right.
Yeah, I might start applying to some of those. And,
yeah. Are you familiar with, is it Just Kids? It's kind of been part of this unexpected movement that I guess has been brought down to Fort Smith.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with those guys? Or?
Yeah, and I've been like a volunteer and an assistant from that kind of from the beginning. Even before it started, I'm friends with one of the founders, John McIntosh. And
right.
I had met with him. He was trying to figure out a way I could be involved, you know, be an assistant or something. First year, but I had already had my Enjoy Local mural scheduled, the lift and everything.
Right.
I ended up missing most of the first year. But yeah, I was just like blown away. They never really told me what artists were coming and stuff. So then when I found out, I was like, oh man, I was really bummed I missed most of it. But then I was sure to be a part the next year. So I was down there and then. A lot of the organizers know I'm an artist.
Right.
And, so they've made an effort to make sure I get with as many artists as
I
can. So it's been great. I've got to work with a lot of them. And as they kind of realize that I can paint too, they're like, well, come back, help, you know, because they're all on time constraints and stuff. So, there's been quite a few of them I've got to help with. And, it's just amazing.
Yeah.
You know, it's inspiring because they're really doing, you know, their own artwork. And, you know, they have a lot of artistic.
Sure.
It truly made me want to go that direction.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you definitely got the talent for sure. Just the stuff I've seen you do with your. One thing I like about your work, it seems to stand the test of time. You know, like it's not so trendy where you go like, oh, that was really cool 5 years ago, but now it's kind of like, eh. So I think that's a credit to you as well.
Yeah, I really end up putting a lot of thought into my work. Yeah, it's I keep it like whimsical and lighthearted too, so it doesn't feel like heavy. But I like to add the layers in. There's the more you look at it, there's more going on.
So is there a new robot or a new creature we can look forward to from Jason Jones? You got a new concept in your brain that you haven't been able to execute yet that we could maybe find you a wall for?
I need some more walls. What I've really been wanting to do is maybe come up with some collaborations with some other artists.
Yeah.
I've gotten to know like Anna Maria. She's one of the artists that came with the unexpected and actually ended up moving to Fort Smith. I've been hoping maybe her and I could work on a wall together, or there's some other local artists that I've been talking with about doing some stuff.
Yeah.
I think that would be fun.
Yeah, I agree.
Some things up.
So yeah.
There's some walls that are in talks and work.
Nothing's,
you know, real solid yet, but.
That's cool. Well, Jason, thanks for your time. It was great to hang out with you today. Appreciate it.
It's an honor.
Yeah.
Pleasure.